Hello and welcome. Now, Blackfriars is a complicated little spot in London. There's been four different bridges and multiple stations. In the episode today, we're focusing on some of the hidden history surrounding the bridges, but there are two great videos about the complexities of the various stations, which I've linked to below. One of them is by Jago Hazard. If you enjoy my videos, I'm sure you'd enjoy his. And one is by absolute tube and train expert, Jeff Marshall. So they're linked below. My name's Katie, your guide to London's hidden history. I'm a qualified Blue Badge tourist guide, and I'm back running private tours and public walks. They're selling out pretty quickly, so if you want to be the first to hear when new dates are on sale, you can sign up to my newsletter, again, linked in the description. So let's start with the very first road, Blackfriars Bridge. It was designed by Robert Milne, and work began in 1760. It covered over what remained of the Fleet River, which is now pretty much a sewer, and still can be seen emptying into the River Thames just under the current Blackfriars Railway Bridge at low tide. It was meant to be named William Pitt Bridge after the Prime Minister, but such is politics that by the time it opened in 1769, Pitt wasn't as popular, and so it took the name of a former monastery, Blackfriars. The Blackfriars Monastery was established in the 1200s and occupied a huge area of land until the Reformation in the 1530s. Today, the only publicly accessible bit that can be seen is a section of wall in the former St Anne Blackfriars churchyard. Of course, you also have the wonderful Blackfriar pub and the cheerful little monk that smiles on passers-by. From 1833, the bridge needed extensive repairs, and eventually it was decided to rebuild it entirely. So the original Blackfriars Bridge was demolished in 1860. Now this brings us onto the Blackfriars Railway Bridge. It started in 1863 when the London, Chatham and Dover Railway Company buys land on Southwark Street to build a goods and a passenger station. The station, known as Blackfriars Bridge, opened on the 1st of June 1864, and it had two levels, the upper one for passengers and the lower for goods. And actually, just before you get to Southwark Street today, you can still see the ramp that allowed access, as well as parts of the brick viaduct. London, Chatham and Dover Railway Company had some serious ambition, and as you go inside the modern Blackfriars Railway Station today, you can see a saved panel showing some of the places that you can visit. This is somewhat misleading, as you had to change onto a steamship at Dover. Now, the tracks from the south side of the river crossed over the bridge and ended at a station known as Ludgate Hill. It no longer exists today, but if you head to Apothecary Street, you can find these steps and then look down onto the tracks, which are still used today. As a popular rail route into the city, a second railway bridge opened downstream in 1886, and another station was built on the north side, St Paul's Station. Confusingly, this is a different station entirely from the current St Paul's Station, which was previously called Post Office. This new railway bridge was known as St Paul's Railway Bridge and operated by a totally different company. The St Paul's station on the north side was renamed Blackfriars in 1937, and today is the site of the entrance into Blackfriars. I told you it was a bit complicated. Skipping forward to the 1980s, Thames Link was extended across London, and the old Blackfriars Railway Bridge wasn't considered strong enough for the new trains. It was demolished in 1985, but you can still see the red pillars that are the former supports for the railway bridge. These just stand here. Architectural historian Pevsner has a lovely description of them. One of the strangest sights in London, marching across the river, carrying nothing to nowhere. Today, these are just empty, but Matt Brown, the editor-at-large at Londonist, has a fantastic idea, which I think we should all get behind. What about using these as bases for the fourth plinth statues from Trafalgar Square? I think it could work. But back to the present day traffic and footbridge. As I mentioned, Milne's earlier bridge was demolished in 1860, and the current bridge was opened by Queen Victoria in 1869. You can see her statue on the north side. This was at a time when the Queen was in a deep depression following the death of Prince Albert in 1861. She'd retreated from public life and was rarely seen. This led to her popularity deteriorating as the public lost patience, questioning what was the point of a queen that you never saw. This is also one of London's talking statues, so you can scan the code and give Victoria a phone call to hear her speak. The bridge itself is made of 5 wrought iron arches designed by Joseph Cubitt. It's owned and maintained by Bridge House Estates, which look after all of the bridges within the City of London area. Another city connection is the lovely little pocket park called Rennie Gardens. And officially, this is looked after by the City of London, despite being outside of their area. Along the bridge itself, there are also some other nice seated areas. They're formed like a pulpit, a reference to the Blackfriars Monastery that I mentioned before, but look a little closer because they're decorated with beautiful stone carvings covered in birds. And these are by John Burney Phillip. Now, if you look over one side, downstream, closer to the sea, they show marine birds, whereas upstream on the other side, they show freshwater birds. Finally, let's look at the current railway bridge. This is an upgrade of the second railway bridge, remember the one that used to be called St Paul's Railway Bridge, built in 1864. But from 2012, Thames Link has embarked on a series of upgrades. They opened a southern entrance, and so still today it is the only railway station in London that has an entrance on both sides of the River Thames. By the southern entrance, you can currently see a fantastic artwork by the Australian street artist Jimmy C. Another part of the upgrade was the widening of the railway bridge. We previously mentioned these red pillars. Today we can see 2, but there were actually 3 at one point. And when the railway expanded, they took over 1 of these pillars. While you're admiring the new station, look up to the roof. It has 4,400 photovoltaic panels on the roof. This makes it the largest solar bridge in the world. And it might just be able to claim that it also has the best views of any central London railway stations, with fabulous vistas across the River Thames. So I did say it was a little bit complicated. Over the history of 4 different bridges, hopefully now you have some fun things to look out for when you're next walking over the bridge or catching a train from Blackfriars Station. I'll be back next week with more of London's hidden history.